Hello everyone. In this video, we will be discussing about 5 questions which relate to week 4 of the deep learning course. So let's look at the 5 questions. The first question relates to distinguish between underfitting and overfitting in the context of machine learning. So in the context of machine learning, we generally divide the data set into 2 subsets. One of which is the training data set and the other one is the test data set. The machine learning model is trained using the training data set and the trained model is validated using the test data set. The machine learning model is said to be underfitting the training data when the error encountered during the training is higher than the acceptable threshold. On the other hand, if the error is within bounds, and the training data and the error encountered during the training phase is low, but the error encountered on the test data set is high, this means that the trained model cannot be generalized over diverse data sets. So let's look at a few examples. For example, when we have a set of data points represented by X in this figure, and we have a simplified model which is trying to model the data points represented by all of these X. As we see in this model, not all the data points are being covered adequately by our proposed model. And so in this case, we say that our model is underfitting the training data. Now let's look at the case of overfitting. If we look at the next figure, here we have the model which is covering each individual point. So all of these X's are being traversed by the segregation model developed by us. And essentially what is happening is this particular model is very useful for the training data set that we have, which is represented by all our X's. But it cannot be generalized to any arbitrary data set. For example, if we provide this model for making an inference using a test data set, we are likely to encounter a large number of errors. So that is why overfitting is a problem. And an ideal representation of the model should be something of this sort, where we have a balance between overfitting and underfitting. So although we are covering most of our data points, but we are not trying to overfit, we are not trying to ensure that our data is fitting the training data set too firmly, which makes it irrelevant for making generalized prediction. Now let us look at the second question. List out some of the commonly encountered activation functions in deep learning models. In neural networks, an activation function represents a nonlinear transformation applied to the weighted inputs of a neuron to determine its output. So this is what the model looks like. We have the inputs which are represented by x1 and x2. Then we have the weights which are w1 and w2. The neuron is represented by the central circle. The neuron is divided into 2 parts. One is the weighted sum of the incoming inputs. And then we have the activation function, which is represented by F. So the output of the neuron can be represented as F of W1 X1 plus W2 X2. So this will be the output that we would expect to receive out of the neuron. The function of interest in this particular diagram is represented by F, which is the nonlinear activation function, which is what introduces nonlinearity into this whole neural network paradigm. So some of the commonly encountered activation functions include the step transition, sigmoid, ReLU, softmax, tanH, etc. Now let's look at all of these activation functions one by one. And so we have the, for step transition, we have fx equal to 0 when x is less than 0, and fx equal to 1 when x is greater than or equal to 0. So this looks like a step, and that is why the name step transition. Next we have sigmoid function. The sigmoid function takes the form fx is equal to 1 by 1 plus e raised to the power minus x. So this varies between 0 and 1. So the y coordinates are between 0 and 1. And the function is infinite in terms of its domain scope. So it ranges from minus infinity to plus infinity. Then we have the ReLU function. The ReLU function consists of two parts. One is, the first part is represented by the value 0, which is for all values of x less than 0. And the second part is a linear function, which ranges from 0 to infinity. So in a concise form, it can be represented as fx equal to max of 0 to x. Then softmax is another popular activation function. Here, as we see, that the range is between minus 1 to plus 1. So if we distinguish it from sigmoid, sigmoid was ranging from 0 to 1. Then similarly, we have the tanH function. The tanH function is represented by e raised to the power x minus e raised to the power minus x, divided by e raised to the power x plus e raised to the power minus x. This again ranges from minus 1 to plus 1, and it is also referred to as the hyperbolic tangent activation function. Now let's look at the third question. Which is, what is the problem in using the threshold function for deep neural networks? Now, learning in deep neural network happens using the backpropagation algorithm. During the backpropagation process, the weights on the neural network are adjusted using the gradient of the error function with respect to the existing weight. So the training in the neural network happens using a greedy algorithm called backpropagation. And what it does is it tries to determine the error between the predicted output and the actual output. And then it tries to adjust the weights of the network based on this error encountered. And for this purpose, it uses a gradient of the error function. Now, if we use a threshold function as our activation function, the activation function will need to be differentiable. And since if we look at the threshold function, it is a stepwise function and it is not differentiable at all points. So that is the problem that we encounter when we use the threshold function for training of deep neural networks. Next question is related to the vanishing gradient problem in deep neural networks. So deep neural network training process involves backpropagation, where the network's weight is updated based on the gradient of the error function with respect to the existing weight. If the gradient is too small or close to zero, the weight update ceases and the learning process of the network stops. The problem arises as the gradient vanishes and is therefore called the vanishing gradient problem. The type of activation function used has a significant impact on the severity of the vanishing gradient problem. For example, the ReLU activation function is preferred to the tanH activation function from a vanishing gradient problem mitigation standpoint. This is because the derivative of the ReLU function is either 0 or 1 and is never negative. So the vanishing gradient problem occurs when the derivative of the function becomes so small or close to 0 such that the impact of the gradient becomes almost 0. So in order to avoid that, we need to choose the activation function properly, and ReLU is one of the activation functions which is commonly preferred in these kinds of scenarios. So this is the ReLU activation function. The red graph shows the actual function and the blue graph shows the derivative of the ReLU function. The derivative is 0 for all values of x less than 0, and the derivative is 1 for all values of x greater than 0. The next question relates to designing a simple neural network which implements the Boolean function x1, xnor, x2. Here x1 and x2 are the inputs, and we are trying to model the function x1, xnor, x2. This function returns true or 1 if and only if the two inputs x1 and x2 are either both true or both false. So this is the proposed model of the x1, xnor, x2 neural network. We have the inputs x1 and x2, and we add a bias of +1. The weights are initialized as 0.5 from +1 to the node A1. So A1 and A2 belong to the first hidden layer, and A3 corresponds to the output. The weights of the edges coming from +1, x1 and x2 to A1 are 0.5, -1 and -1 respectively. Similarly, the weights of the edges coming from +1, x1 and x2 to A2 are -1.5, 1 and 1 respectively. Weight from A1 to A3 and A2 to A3 are 1. Similarly, we have a bias applied at the output node, and that the weight of the edge connecting the bias of +1 to the output node is -0.5. Now let's analyze this network and see how it models x1, xnor, x2. So x1 and x2 are the inputs. A1, A2 and A3 are neurons with the activation function fx equal to 0 if x is less than 0 and fx equal to 1 if x is greater than equal to 0. So essentially it represents a step function. So what is the truth table? We have x1 and x2 which vary from 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0 and 1, 1. If we set x1 and x2 as 0 both, then we find that a1 is 1. How does it become 1? Because the inputs x1 and x2 are both 0. So the weighted sum of these inputs becomes 0. So the activation function will trigger because the weighted sum of the inputs and the bias is greater than 0. So the weighted sum is actually 0.5 and it's greater than 0, so A1 will trigger. But if we look at the node A2, here x1 into 1 plus x2 into 1 is 0 because both x1 and x2 are 0. But the bias is -1.5, which is less than 0. So that is why the output of A2 will be 0. So the output of A1 is 1, output of A2 is 0. Now let's look at what will A3 return. So A1 is 1, so 1 into 1 plus 0 into 1. Now adding the bias, it's -0.5. So 1 minus 0.5 is 0.5. That is greater than 0, so A3 will trigger. Similarly, we can compute when x is 0, x1 is 0 and x2 is 1, and also when x1 is 1, x2 is 0 and x1 is 1, x2 is 1. In these cases, the output will be 1 only when x1 is equal to x2. Either both x1 and x2 are 0 or both x1 and x2 are 1. In that case, the output will be 1. So essentially, we can use this network to model the x1, xnor, x2 function. So these are the 5 questions related to the week 4 module. Thank you very much.